Hey, guys.
Thank you very much for having me.
My name is Jeff Comer. I was telling him, I moved to North Carolina in 2005. And when I moved to North Carolina in 2005, I worked for EMC. I don't know if you guys are familiar or do any work with them, you know, storage company. And I was 100% dedicated to SLED, so city, county, and K-12. And so I joined Nickel Jesus in 2005 and was very active in Nickel Jesus through like 2008. And then my career kind of turned path. So, yes, sir.
You said SLED?
SLED. Yeah, state, local, and education. That's what vendors call the space. I didn't have the state though. I just had city and county in Western North Carolina. So, but I've had a lot of really good, long-lasting relationships with folks in the Nickel Jesus organization. Still to this day, large thanks to social media and things like that. I still feel like a friend with all these guys. I was the general manager of security for a company called Varro. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Varro, but Varro was a company that was based in the Carolinas, and we were focused only in North and South Carolina. A really great story of a company that grew from basically nothing in 2008 to $150 million business at the time that we were acquired almost 2 years ago. So I was acquired by this company called Sirius Computer Solutions, which is a huge technology integrator. So we're out of San Antonio, Texas. We're like a $2 billion company. So that's been growing pains for me to go from working in a small local company to this large company. But my title now is the manager of security solutions. So the good news for you guys is I'm not gonna stand up here and talk for 2 hours, anywhere near 2 hours. The bad news is you guys got the B team here. We have our biggest event in our company yesterday, so a lot of the technical guys that I wanted to be here are not here, but hopefully this will be beneficial for you guys. I do work in security all day, every day, and any questions that you guys have, you know, please ask. The one benefit that I can provide is I do meet with about probably 7 to 8 customers per week. So I know what people are facing from a challenge perspective. I know where people are having success. I know what's working and not working out there. So any questions before I get started?
How was Madness this year?
It was awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I lost my voice. Like I said, all my engineers are there. Yeah, we created this thing called Varro Madness like 6 years ago. We had it the first day of the basketball tournament. We had like 60 technical breakout sessions. There's a bunch of vendors there. We feed you breakfast, we feed you lunch. They give away tons of prizes, TVs, all that stuff. If you've never been, definitely go next year. It's free of charge. If you've been before, you can tell them. I'm not $2 more. It is an awesome event. It's the kind of event that you would have to fly to Vegas for typically, but we have it right here in the
crowd. The think tank sessions the think tank sessions are what's valuable because, you know, you pair up with, like, I think Pete Flutie was out there, and, you know, just if you got questions about, you know, virtualization or anything running, you know, that you can go to talk to them, and you have an engineer that can pretty much just help you and guide you where you need to be on some things too.
So unfortunately, because they were all doing that, all hands on deck in our meeting, but y'all just stuck with me today, but we'll see what we can do. So these are just some things that, like I said, from traveling and talking to other customers, these are just some things that I like to get across to customers when I'm talking about, this isn't necessarily network security specific, but this is just security in general. The first thing that I've been spending a lot of time talking about is very popular now, is end-user education. So how many of you guys have a mature, or you feel like you have a mature end-user education perspective from as far as security is concerned? I mean, that is it's still like, if you look at the reports, right, still about almost 80% of breaches now are still caused by somebody clicking on a malicious link. Most of the time now it's through email. A lot of times it's through websites that you know that people search malware, but most of it is from email. So one of the things you can do from a network security perspective is, again, obviously when you're onboarding employees, if you're not doing this with your, you know, with your city, county, or school or whatever, when you're onboarding employees, you want to make sure that there's some security training involved in that. And then, you know, you need to have some type of security training probably at least annually, maybe biannually if you can get away with it. And it needs to be like very much the culture of the organization, you know, from a flyers, posters, updates perspective. One of the things we talked about yesterday is rewarding employees for sending, you know, your IT team something that may look suspicious. Build that culture. Like in the, you know, in the industrial revolution, right, we had all these accidents were happening in all these factories, right? And we created, you know, OSHA to help protect from that. And if you go into a factory now, if anybody's ever, I used to work in a paper mill, you walk into a factory, all you see is stay safe, 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 safe. It's all about safety. It's all about safety. It's constantly beating to your head as it needs to be. We need to have that kind of culture from a security perspective moving into the new generation that we're in, because it's a very dangerous world out there. It's only going to get worse. So I would encourage you guys. I mean, there's like SANS. Is anybody familiar with SANS security organization? Yeah. Yeah, so I mean, there's free stuff, free videos. You can do your own, build your own posters. I just really encourage that. All this fancy stuff that we can talk about, at the end of the day, if you can make a user smarter, you can make your environment much safer. The other thing is vulnerability and patch management process. This is like, so I'm a sales guy, really, at the end of the day, and I sell a lot of real, I could tell you guys, and I will if you want to, offline or whatever, about all these cool new technologies and all these cool tools that are out there. They're coming out with some really awesome whiz bang stuff that, you know, we sell it, and hey, that's how I feed my kids, so I like selling it, don't get me wrong. But a lot of times I'm talking to customers about all these advanced security tools, and the first thing, vulnerability management and patch management, which is the foundation blocking and tackling of every security environment, is not being done. So I don't know, you guys please discuss with me. I mean, a lot of times, right, so what is the problem when I talk to customers that don't have a good vulnerability and patch management program? Usually they say, well, I'm not allowed to scan, the business won't let me run the scans because they think the scans are impacting, you know, the performance of the environment, and the business doesn't let me scan the systems. Well, I can't do the patches, because, you know, the application team is worried that it's going to break something, and we don't have a good patch testing program. I can't do the patches because I can't get the downtime. You look like you want to say something. Maybe not. I'm not putting it on the spot. All this sound familiar to you guys? Or?
Yeah, especially if you're in the trenches. Because if it's just you in the trenches, and you got like 60, 70 PCs, and, you know, and that's why I went away from having my own email server.
Right.
Why? Because every time one of my people get a virus and their machine just starts to become a robot, and it's like the state will come in and shut me down.
Got y'all your machines again.
And when after you went through this three times, it was time to say, let somebody else handle the email.
Yeah.
That's what I offsite in my email. I let somebody else handle it. So if I got machines that got issues, I ain't got the state shutting me down.
Where do you work?
Pamlico County Social Services.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, it's, you know, do this. If you're not doing it, again, it's, you know, like 98% of the breaches that we face could be stopped with a good, strong patch management or vulnerability and patch management program. All the other stuff we talk about really is that last, you know, 2%. One of the sessions that we had yesterday, one of the presenters was talking about the fact that there's still like CVEs being exploited from like 1998. So, I mean, think about that. These are 20 years, over 20 year old vulnerabilities that are still being exploited by hackers today in 2017. Policy creation and unity with the business. I mean, I guess this is public sector, but it's still a business, I guess, right?
It is.
You know, another part about these tools I buy, and I was just talking to you about like application, you know, talking about network security, application visibility, right? Moving away from port protocol to application-based security on the network, and user ID, identifying users with applications. Well, I sell a lot of this stuff to IT departments, and then this is all kind of the same thought with the 80% implementation. I sell it to the IT department, and all of a sudden it's IT's responsibility to decide who does what with what applications and who has what permissions and who has what rights. And I'll say, You know, IT has historically done that, and you guys are doing that, but I think it's really not your job. I mean, you may want it to be your job. If you do, that's fine. You don't have to listen to me. But really, there needs to be very strong communication with, you know, the department heads, or whatever you would call the business units, to understand, you know, with them, okay, what data is valuable to you? You know, what risk is associated with the different types of data that you own? Like, that's not IT's decision, but we have to do a better job of communicating with the business. I think most of the time when we try to communicate with the business, you know, they probably don't talk back to us as much as we'd like, but we got to force that. What data is critical to you? Where does it reside? You know, let's not just talk about IT risk, let's talk about business risk, and let's talk about what do your employees need access to? What applications do they need to have? I mean, obviously some things are easy, right? Like, you know, pornography or hate or crime or whatever, you know, but a lot of other stuff, right, is you guys are having to make decisions about that. Security framework. How many of you guys have a security framework that you adhere to? Like NIST or ISO 27001, even the SANS top 20 critical security controls. So nobody's ready. All right, there we go.
I see a malware attack at the firewall, I get to the workstation and fix it.
Okay. There you go. Well,
it's not necessarily, I mean, not the main word.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you obviously have regulatory compliance. I'm sure, you know, everybody's facing regulatory compliance. Probably most of you have the health department of some type, so you probably have HIPAA that you have to deal with, right?
Yeah.
Probably most of you have to deal with PCI if you're, you know, got parking meters or parking tickets or tax or whatever, if you're accepting credit cards for any of that stuff. So you probably have to deal with PCI. I doubt any of you are a level one merchant where you have to have a QSA, you know, PSI, PCI assessment. Probably most of you self-report on that, right? From a PCI. Be a level one merchant, you're talking like really large retailers that do millions of transactions. They have to have somebody called a qualified security assessor come in and still there. So you've got regulatory compliance that you need to adhere to. Well, what I'm talking about here is more of a framework, you know, like it could just be the SANS top 20 critical controls or ISO. But the reason that I say that you need to adhere to a security framework is it goes back to that I was talking about vulnerability and patching, and it goes back to, you know, policy creation with the business. If you have a framework that you adhere to, that's agreed upon, you've got a certain way of doing things, and it's stated and it's documented. And so all of these exceptions and all these things that come up for discussion, you know, can be squandered because we've got this framework we agree to and we adhere to. Yes, sir.
Do you have to involve some protocol point tree when the questions are posed by the manager? You can point to these protocols within your security framework and say, hey, we're doing this because we're adhering to these protocols within the security framework.
Exactly. And that's like, and that's when, hey, you can't run scans. Well, we have to run scans. You can't patch the systems. We have to, you know, this is what we do. And one of the things that we tell customers to do all the time, you know, is make, you know, build as part of this. You can build a risk acceptance document or a risk acceptance plan to the business. So people ask you to start doing things, then you can say, okay, I'll do that. I need these security controls. I need this, that, the other thing to do it the right way, blah, 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 blah. And they say, no, you can't do that. Just go do it. You say, okay, well, here's the stated risk that I gave you, here's the risk acceptance document plan that you guys, you know, now you sign that and tell me that you're accepting the risk based on what I told you. Then it gets squirrely and hurried a lot of times. But no, we see that all the time. I mean, I had a healthcare provider here in North Carolina that, you know, they all of a sudden decided, their business unit all of a sudden decided that they wanted to start doing shared services of their Electronic Medical Records Act. The guy told me, he's like, what do I need to do that from a security perspective? I'm like, oh, good Lord, man. I mean, a lot, right? A lot of controls you're going to have to put on that environment. The other thing I would say, lack of professional development on tool sets. So again, I'm a sales guy by trade. I've been doing sales for 20 years now. We work on the big deal. We're working on the deal with you guys to sell you the new thing, and you know, your budget is $100,000 bucks, and I'm coming in at $112,000. and you're beating me up, and I'm trying to get it down, and I'm calling my boss, and negotiating and all that, and then what do? Cut the training out of it, you know? And I tell, from a security perspective, like, don't, if you can't afford the training, you can't afford the tool, period. Don't buy it. Because so many customers, so many clients that I work with have so many different tools, and they're getting that 80% implementation out of it. Which is terrible. And most of the reason that they're getting an 80% implementation is because the person who's administering the tool is not an expert on the tool. They're a novice, they're self-taught most of the time. I mean, it's not their fault, they're doing everything that they can, but, you know, somebody that can really make a firewall, one of these next-gen firewalls home, that really knows what they're doing, is gonna have a lot more protected environment than somebody who figured out how to manage the thing on YouTube. You know, I mean, that's just the reality of the situation. And that's another thing, like I said, 80% implementation, so much of that out there. So shore up what you have. Again, vulnerability and patch management. Do that, you're gonna solve a lot of problems. Any questions about any of that? That's just some of my thoughts from the road, things that I see. I'm going the wrong way. What I'm going to talk to you guys today about network security, really the topic could be network segmentation. That's really kind of the focus of what I'm talking about. You know, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the SOSIS line, but it was started back in Russian submarines back during the Cold War. Bell Labs built these devices. They're all over the ocean. I mean, that's really what security is all about. It's about listening, and listening everywhere in the environment, not just, you know, at the perimeter. So this is, I don't know if this is what you guys look like today. This is what most of the customers that I work with, you know, look like today. Obviously, they've got the outside world. Everybody pretty much has some type of firewall, right? I mentioned next-gen firewalls. If you guys are running like legacy firewalls, port and protocol-based firewalls that aren't application-aware firewalls, all the vendors make them now. I was telling them, like, Palo Alto Networks kind of started it out, but all the vendors are doing it now. You know, again, I'm a sales guy, but I'm telling you, you should invest in it if you're not doing it, because it really is a game changer, that technology is, right? So some type of firewall. How many of you have IPS that's in place? Okay, so that's good, but not even everybody does, right? A lot of people are doing IDS, you know, detection on things. A lot of people talk about 80% implementations. When people try to implement IPS, what happens? They start breaking things. You know, they turn it off. Or they're only blocking the high criticals. They're not blocking, you know. But, you know, we see all the time just through, you know, moderate alerts, people getting infected, right? So that's another place where you really have to tune. But then you have a DMZ, you got a firewall off that. And that's the way that a lot of our organizations, obviously there's endpoint security, but that's the way a lot of our organizations work. And it's a perimeter-based approach to security. So you're listening at the perimeter. You've got controls at the perimeter. But once you get past the perimeter, there's no ability, and I don't work with all you guys personally, but in many places, there's no ability to hear what's going on inside. So that's why if you read these breach reports, they'll tell you that most of the time, the dwell time of a breach, as far as when an environment was compromised and when it's detected, is about 8 months. Almost 8 months. That time frame in the studies is actually ticking down a little bit, so that means that we're doing better. Another statistic on top of that is that 66% of the time, or two-thirds of the time, the breach is actually not detected by the organization that's been breached. It's detected by somebody else. And I can tell this story because I've got permission to tell this story, but how many of you guys are familiar with the South Carolina Department of Revenue snafu about 4 or 5 years ago? So that was one of the biggest security incidents in the world, really. the way that it happened, anecdotal story. I'm going to walk over and get a water. Just kind of a funny story. The way that it happened was, you know, we have our FBI and our CIA and all these guys. They, you know, they've got secret agents out there that are buying identities and things of that nature out on the black market. So these guys that are in the FBI, CIA, whatever agency they were in, they started noticing all of a sudden, like, they're over in Eastern Europe and they're buying all these identities, and they're like, all these people are from South Carolina. Like, you know, they started seeing a ton of the identities from South Carolina. So they started investigating it, and, you know, they figured out, they were like, okay, well, this is because of this breach. I mean, the Department of Revenue, that's every single taxpayer and every single citizen of the state of South Carolina. And what they do when they get that information, they sell it on the black market, and then what they do is they file fraudulent tax returns in your name.
So the FBI would buy them off the black market.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're buying them off, and they notice the correlation of, like, why so many of them were from South Carolina. Yeah. But then they go, they file fraudulent tax returns. So one of the guys that I work with on the security team had, and you would think the government would be a little bit better at detecting some of these anomalies, and they're getting better. This guy said he never had a tax return in his life, you know, maybe $400 or $500 or something. They filed a return that gave him an $18,000 refund in his name. And they, you know, they don't have the controls to see it. You know, they got their 18 grand, they're gone. Then he goes to actually file his private tax return, and then you got to deal with that mess. But the people at South Carolina Department of Revenue, you know, I know this guy personally, like I said, I got permission. He said he picked up the phone and he was like, beep, 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 beep. And they were like, is this so-and-so? And he was like, yeah. And they were like, this is so-and-so from the FBI. This is so-and-so from the CIA. This is so-and-so from whatever. You know, he's on the phone, and, you know, but he's thinking, oh, boy, here we go. And, you know, and they told him what had happened. But again, you know, that's... So what I'm describing here when I talk about, you know, network segmentation is, again, working with the business, having some type of, I keep going the wrong way on this thing, I'm sorry. Having some type of segmentation between the different areas of the business, whether it's HR data, finance data, marketing data, business data, IT data, and some type of protections in between the database and the application. How many of you guys are doing, do most of you guys have relatively flat networks, or how many of you guys are doing that today?
Segregated.
Right. Okay.
Previous place that had it more segmented, our master group flat
right now. So,
people hate. The more security you put in place, the more difficult it is. People hate to fight it.
What aspect of it do they hate to fight?
Well, just making things work requires opening up ports.
So, right.
You know, it's they used to just having things work, you know,
mm-hmm.
without much to do with
it. Right.
It's not the way to do things.
Well, one of the things I actually forgot to mention is you mentioned opening up ports. This is one of the most common things that I see, and it goes back to kind of the security framework and security policy and procedure. How many times when you get a request to open up something on a firewall, do you ask the question, how long do you need it? And then when you find out how long do they need it, then you say, how do we shut it down, and then have the process to go back down and close it after that time is needed. So that's another thing that we see in the field. Like when we sell somebody a new set of firewalls and we're doing a migration, they're like, man, we got rule sets for 15, 20 years, right? You know, thousands and thousands of firewall rules on some of these implementations that have, you know, have never been reviewed. But should a financial user ever be accessing the database directly?
No. They should have all what they need to know.
Would you
do a job?
Would you be able to see that in your environment if they were?
No. I have got the directory. Types of data and information. Only give that person security. I mean, access to that. I'll block all other security.
Right. But you could have a compromised user that has some type of connection to directly to the database server and no visibility to it.
And I've had those issues too before.
So what basically what I'm saying is there needs to be rules between each segment, the data needs to be segmented, you know, by department, by user, by application, and there needs to be rules, and not only rules, but there need to be controls that are put in place, like data firewalls inside the data center, to protect yourselves from direct application and force the end users to go through, you know, through the DMZ, through the application server to access the data to the database. And a lot of times, if we don't have some type of segmentation in the environment, we just can't simply, because of all of our protection and all of our controls are on the outside, you know, we simply can't see that type of activity. The other thing that we need to be doing is understanding NetFlow, collecting NetFlow, and understanding what traffic we have in our network, who's talking to who, who's talking inside the environment, what host can communicate to the other host. And, oh man, sorry man, this thing is messing me up. I'm not used to this fancy technology. And have some type of system to collect all of that logs and all that information and make sense of all that communication. Do you guys have any type of like SIM solution that you have in place where you've got a centralized logging system to collect all this information in a single pane of glass to give you visibility to it? What do you guys run? Okay.
Followed all the way back to the port. And we've got 30 days. We can go back 30 days.
That's right.
From all the way back to the main room.
Okay.
Got records for that.
Yeah.
But it goes, kind of goes way after 30 days. After 30 days, we can't see anything from the next step.
Right. Does it do any type of correlation for you to say, you know, we've seen this event happen, we've seen this event happen, this is something where you can build a rule?
Identify the type of data transfer, type of port that's being used, for example, Windows file transfers, their label.
Yeah.
SMTP transfer label, you know, that's what it's like.
Right. So these like SIM technologies that stand for Security Incident Event Management. But you know, the purpose of them is when you have a bunch of sensors, when you're collecting data at multiple locations within the environment, you're creating, there's a lot of different things for you to look at, right? So it can be very difficult from a management perspective to understand all of the controls that you have in the environment. You know, obviously you can't review logs of all these things all the time. It's just a very, very difficult task. As a matter of fact, like probably the most things breach, the target breach, they had a technology called FireEye, which is a network security product. Basically, what it does is it detects malware with known or unknown malware on your network and gives you a notification to say, hey, we think we see malware in the environment. The FireEye actually did its job. So the FireEye was alerting the target security team that there was a problem. The issue there was the target security team had so much what they call white noise, so many notifications that were going off that they didn't pay attention to that particular incident because it was, you know, just like everything else. So the purpose of what a SIM is supposed to do, a security incident event manager, you tune these things to where you say, okay, well, it looks like I had, you know, several failed login attempts over here. And now this end user who doesn't typically access this application, or this end user that doesn't, you know, typically do things at this work, it correlates all the events, it takes logs and collects logs from all of your environment, correlates all the events, and then says, hey, this is something that you should be paying attention to.
What's the problem? We're using Cisco Firepower, FireSight.
Yep.
It doesn't seem that granular.
Yeah.
Plus it's at the edge.
Yeah.
So it's not getting everything in there. So what's the product that really gets down to auditing the user activity to
the security? Well, I mean, there's different things that do activity, but for SIMs, like the most popular SIMs in the marketplace are like Splunk. You guys are familiar with Splunk.
Yeah.
They've got an application. You know, you can use Splunk for a lot of things.
That's part of FireSight.
Yeah. QRadar is a big one. RSA has one called Envision or Security Analytics. McAfee has one, Nitro. There's a lot of vendors out there. I can tell you one thing, Well, let me kind of finish talking about the tool, but what you get the correlation of that, and you want to tune it down to where you get when you see something that's actionable, you're like, you don't want white noise, you don't want to see everything, but you want to get it tuned to where you see something that's actionable, you know how to respond to that event. One of the things that I actually encourage a lot of my clients to do, and really what the majority of my clients do in that space, is they don't even have an on-premise like SIM. They'll use some type of managed service to do that. So they'll collect their logs on their site, and they'll, you know, package them and encrypt them and send them to, you know, somebody that provides a managed service to do 24/7/365 security monitoring for them. Because, you know, again, that's a very difficult. Do what? Probably the most popular one is probably like Dell SecureWorks, if you're familiar with them. I think I saw them at Nickel Giza. You know, Symantec does it, Verizon, AT&T. We partner with a company called AlertLogic that does it. We partner with a company called Solutionary, NTT, that does it. So, and a lot of times, I mean, a lot of times it's less expensive to do it that way too. Absolutely not, no. I mean, as a matter of fact, from a HIPAA perspective, you really need to be, you know, as the way I read HIPAA, the required, you know, controls, they've obviously got required controls and addressable controls. The way that I read it, the required controls are encryption, some type of vulnerability management, patch management, and some type of log correlation, log review. So when you're getting an audit from a HIPAA perspective, it would be very common for the auditor to say, okay, you show me what your, you know, centralized log correlation and what your log review process is. So like these partners that I work with, like we work with AlertLogic, you get a HIPAA audit, you got it right there on your portal, you can be like, oh, this guy right here reviewed my logs at 10:14 p.m. or, you know, whatever, blah, 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 here you go.
Just the metadata
for
the logs.
Yeah. So the next thing, talking about the virtual environment. So are most of you guys pretty heavily virtualized?
Yeah.
You guys using VMware mostly, or?
Yeah. VMware. Citrix, KVM.
Yeah. So how many of you guys have heard of like VMware's NSX solution? So that is basically what they're doing with that NSX solution is they're doing exactly what they did to the server environment, and they're doing it to the network. So you still require the physical layer, layer one. Everything else is virtualized on top of that. So there's a lot of customers that are looking to that because from an operational perspective, it can make things much easier, right? To, you know, create networks and save them, share them, you know, you're doing it all in a virtual world, right? And everything that's in that network is right there virtually. You can create and operationalize things, make things very fast and efficient. Well, the reality is the cost of NSX for most people is not worth it because most of you aren't necessarily like building new networks every day, right? Because you're not in an environment where that's something. Yes, sir.
It's also you got to buy it per prompt.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not like, you know, under the old bit where you could buy a vShield appliance and it was per, you know, vCenter.
Yeah.
Environment. NSX, you now have to buy licensing per prompt. So if you have a UCS plate that's got two processors on it, you got to buy two instances of NSX for that plate.
Right.
So the licensing model has changed from what it used to be as well, so it becomes a lot more
right
costly.
Yeah. And like I said, for most of the people that I work with, now if you're obviously you're a service provider or something, right, and it may, you know, have a return on investment for that, but most of the real reason that a lot of my customers and people that are looking at NSX, and NSX is not the only one out there, obviously, but, you know, similar solutions, is because of what you can do from a security perspective. We're talking about segmentation, so we're talking about putting, you know, firewalls inside the data center, right? Segmenting different applications, segmenting, you know, the web tier, the app tier, the database tier. Like, that requires a lot of physical network work. It requires, you know, re-IPing of things. It can be very complex. It's much easier to do in the virtual world to where you can basically, you know, create the data and the apps and do what they determine that they use as micro segmentation. So every single virtual machine that you have basically has, you know, the firewall protection, the you know, around each individual machine, and that protects you from any east-west traffic and any of that internal movement right there, you know, at the virtual layer. And you can do that layers, you know, 2 through 4, and then you can work with other vendors, right, like Trend Micro, Palo, others like that, to where you can do layers 5 through 7. You can do advanced security, that application type security, that zero-day malware testing on each individual box. And what does that do for you? I mean, from that perspective, it makes it much, much easier to do that segmentation. It gives you that east-west protection. It gives you that east-west visibility. But it also makes it operationally easier when those VMs move around, or if you have a certain, you know, policy for a particular type of host, you can operationalize all those security rules right there on that host, and they stay with it. And if you've got something that needs to go away, it goes away. And, you know, a lot of times we'll have rogue devices out there on our network that we don't know about. When it goes away, never be heard from again. Oh. The other thing is the cloud. How many of you guys are using any cloud shared service providers or any software as a service applications? You guys are? Are you guys using like Azure or AWS, or are you using SaaS applications?
Azure. Yeah. Karen D from the health department, I guess. It's web based.
Yeah.
Hosted in, I'm not sure if it's Azure.
Right. So, yeah, so I mean, one thing to that is, you know, not a lot of you raised your hands, but one thing to that is visibility into cloud and SaaS applications. So, there's a new technology out there. You guys, have you ever heard the term CASB, Cloud Access Security Broker? Cisco just bought a company called CloudLock. Did y'all know about that? And Cisco customers in there? Anyway, make a long story short, a lot of customers, when you'll ask the customer and you'll say, you know, you ask the CIO or whatever, how many cloud SaaS applications do you have at use in your environment by your employees? A lot of times the answer that they give might be like, you know, 7 or 8 or something like that. There's tools that can be put in place now to monitor, right, like through firewall logs and at the internet edge where you'll run an assessment. And what we typically find is after we run that assessment, there's hundreds of cloud SaaS applications being used by employees in the environment. Some of them are sanctioned, right, like yours, that one is sanctioned. Many of them are unsanctioned IT. So then the focus needs to be, you know, the first thing that we want to do is shut down all of the stuff that's unsanctioned, right? So if it's unsanctioned, if it shouldn't be used, we need to be blocking it, we need to stop it. But on the sanctioned stuff, we need to have some type of visibility into what's happening in those cloud SaaS applications. So working with those partners that do things like, you know, virtual firewalls, segmentation, getting logs out of those environments, very important for us, because you can say that, you know, when you put something in the cloud, well, at that point in time, the onus is on that cloud provider, but it's still your data. So it's your data that's out there, so you need to have visibility to it, and you need to have responsibility for it, and you need to have controls around it. So talking about 3 threats, again, around this, zone defense, that's the key. Segmenting the network, it can be very, very difficult, obviously. Again, virtualization can make it a lot easier if you guys want to look that way. Endpoints, how many of you guys have looked at or are using any of these like next generation endpoint technologies?
Microsoft Endpoint Security Account.
Yeah. Right.
But it's not really
Symantec is actually, and we're not even a Symantec partner, so I'm not trying to sell it to you, but Symantec's new release, I think, has a lot of promise. But the problem with a lot of the old, you know, the old AV stuff, the traditional stuff, like Symantec and Trane and Kaspersky and McAfee and all those, is they're based on signatures. So we were having this discussion earlier. So you know, signature-based security, like from an IPS or from an endpoint, is when you say, well, here's all these bad things that we know about. We know about all these bad things. We're going to write a signature, so if we see this bad thing, we're going to block it, we're going to stop it, we're going to notify on it, right? And that's the way that it works. And that was fairly effective like 20 years ago. But the problem now is that there's more malware being generated every single day than there was in any given year 20 years ago. Millions of new, you know, the amount of millions, tens of millions of malware being generated every day. And all they have to do is flip a bit and you have to have a new signature. So doing signature-based security doesn't really work anymore. You have to do something that relies on, you know, either, you know, a sandboxing type technology. And what I'm talking about there is, okay, well, we're going to block all the things that we know are bad, but what if we don't know what it is? If we don't know what it is, then we'll inspect it, we'll put it in a sandbox, we'll kind of detonate it, and we'll see whether it's good or bad, see how it behaves. If it's good, we allow it. If it's bad, you know, we don't. Or maybe put together like a positive security model instead of a negative security model, where you do something like application control, where you say, I'm only going to allow certain things to run on my endpoint. So that's a different way of doing security. Instead of looking for the bad stuff, you only allow the good stuff. Now that requires, again, communication with the business, because the first thing you're going to want to do is get an inventory of everything that's running on the endpoint, everything that you need to do your jobs, everything you need to make your applications work. You want to allow those things, you want to block everything else. That way, you know, if you've got some type of malware, unless it's specifically approved by you to be used, it's not going to execute on the endpoint. The other thing that you can do now is we're starting to see vendors doing things like, you know, using artificial intelligence and machine learning to look for not necessarily a specific signature of a piece of malware, but the way that the endpoint is behaving to notify that something is dangerous in the environment. The other thing is leaving the network after it's segmented. How many of you guys are monitoring what's going outbound on the network as well? So, you know, and a lot of times, like, even just with DNS security, and Cisco bought this company called OpenDNS. I don't know if you guys are familiar with them. They got this product called Umbrella. Not too expensive, easy to put on, good product if you guys like it. But what happens when there's a breach that's occurred, the first thing that they do once they compromise the environment is they'll usually deliver some type of payload, you know, create a command and control. But the next thing that typically has to happen is that malware has to call back out to a location to get additional payload to do what it needs to do. So we don't only need to be looking at what's coming into the environment, but we need to make sure that we're inspecting what's going out of the environment and blocking that, because a lot of times that's exactly, you know, that's where we can actually see it happen sometimes. Well, I think that's it for me. I don't know how long I talked. Any questions? How long did I talk?
45.
Long enough. There you go. Any questions? You guys want to discuss anything? I mean, what are you guys seeing out there? What's your biggest pain point from a security perspective right now?
Biggest problem was spread virus.
Yeah.
And a couple of big issues.
Yeah.
We just did a full password protection implementation.
Okay.
Sandbox and firewall.
Yeah.
In the process of rolling the client for vulnerability and patching.
Yeah. What are you running on your endpoints?
System Center and 41.
Okay.
Yeah, we're running on both.
Okay, cool.
So yeah, it shut down 99%+ of our virus problems.
Right. That's good.
The last 3 months anyway. So if for somebody that was getting crypto every other week, it was a big help.
Yeah, one of our sessions yesterday, they said that ransomware was a $1 billion business. We talked a lot about, you know, preparedness for that, because what they're doing now, if you don't have a, you know, I mean, we could talk about different stuff all day long, I'll shut up after I say this, I promise, but another thing from security, if you don't have a security incident response plan or preparedness plan, that's another thing that you really need to do fundamentally. Because one of the things that's happening now, like these people, they'll hit you and they'll be like, you got 48 hours. They'll put you on the clock to pay, and if you don't, they'll start sending the information out. You know, they're getting very aggressive, and so if this happens to you and you're on the clock and you haven't prepared and you don't know exactly what steps you're going to take, then, you know, it can be very, very dangerous. But thanks for having me, guys.